I just want to introduce Janice Hodson. She's curator of art at the New Bedford Free Public Library. I'm sure you all know about the library, but you might not know that they have one of the most incredible art collections in the region. So please get in touch with Janice and go up to the second, third floor and see the most amazing pieces there. I mean, it's really, Janice is an art historian from BU, and she's been in the library for 9 years. And she's here to talk about that 1858 exhibition that we talked about downstairs in the gallery. Janice Hodson.
My talk deals actually a little more peripherally with Bradford and about this exhibit, which Bradford was a part, that occurred here in New Bedford in 1858. It was the first major art exhibit ever held in New Bedford. For 25 cents, which is approximately the equivalent of $7.43 today, so affordable, members of the community could view 150 paintings that showcased a broad range of subject matter by major metropolitan artists of the period, as well as New Bedford area artists like Bradford. The exhibit was advertised in the New Bedford Mercury, one of our local papers, as containing choice works by the most eminent American artists, together with several pictures by some of the most celebrated living European painters. The local press called it an event, no small event in itself, which was a little bit of an understatement. This exhibit was of significance, and why was that? At this time in the United States, we were still a comparatively young country, there was no equivalent in the United States to the European salon tradition. In the 19th century, even the local New Bedford papers noted the disadvantage that the country was at in that one of the papers specifically stated, it is only by frequent contemplation of works of art that we can learn to judge intelligently of their merit. And the opportunities for doing so are unfortunately too rare in this country. We have no such galleries. The accumulation is of centuries, as may be found in almost every city in the old world, accessible to all without charge. And I would argue that is still an issue in our country. So for the public to be able, in the mid-19th century, to see an exhibit of that many pieces in a city like New Bedford, such an extensive number of works in one place outside of, say, New York at the time, Philadelphia or Boston, was actually exceptional. Support for the arts in America, particularly in the 18th, early 19th century, you could say was lukewarm at best. In the 18th century, John Singleton Copley complained that in America, artists were considered no better than cobblers. New forms of patronage did gradually begin to be seen in the early 19th century. There was a rise which coincided with the increasing economic health of the United States in commissions by wealthy individuals, and also public commissions for the newly constructed federal buildings, for instance. So as those new forms of patronage began to develop, There were attempts made at establishing permanent institutions for art education through the exhibition of art in the United States. The first attempt was the American Academy of Fine Arts. That was established in New York in 1802. It didn't survive for very long. It trained artists in classical tradition. It was considered very conservative. And the students who were part of that academy eventually rebelled and formed the National Academy of Design in 1825. But the first successful art school and art museum was the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, which was established in 1905 to promote the cultivation of the fine arts in the United States of America by exciting the efforts of artists gradually to unfold, enlighten, and invigorate the talents of our countrymen. This, in spite of this, there was still a prejudice against American artists, particularly those who may have been trained here in this country. Most American artists who were serious about becoming artists and trying to make a career out of art chose to receive their academic training abroad, specifically at this time period in London, Munich, Paris, and Dusseldorf. Now here is Albert Bierstadt in his New Bedford studio with some of his patrons, and one of these men is John Hopkins. I think it's the man standing in the back, but I'm not sure. The exhibit, the New Bedford Art Exhibition, was the brainchild of those two men, Bierstadt and Hopkins. Hopkins was a music store owner. He was an ardent supporter of Bierstadt's work and routinely exhibited the canvases that he would ship back from Germany, where Bierstadt was studying at the time in the 1850s, for Hopkins to sell. And that actually helped finance Bierstadt's time in Europe. The Crayon, which was a short-lived but very important art journal in the 19th century, reported in April of 1858 that Bierstadt was trying to mount this exhibition of pictures in New Bedford. Bierstadt had found that, along with Hopkins and a number of other prominent New Bedfordites, specifically the Hathaway family, Charles Fazenden, Captain William Blackler, were very supportive of his burgeoning career, and he apparently thought that the whaling capital of the United States could support such an effort. The Crayon's editor, John Durand, encouraged artists in pages of his journal to include, who were artists who were readers of the journal, to submit their work. And the exhibition opened on July 1st in the Ricketson Block building, which is on Union Street, where Bierstadt had his studio. The majority of the artists who exhibited were American, yet it's telling that the New Bedford Republican Standard, which did an extensive write-up on the exhibit, chose to start out discussing the great foreign artists who had participated, which is a reflection of the continuing belief among American collectors of the superiority of European artists. Now, among the artists who exhibited were people like Sir Edwin Landseer, who were major international figures. Landseer, as some of you may know, was noted for his animal painting, was a favorite of Queen Victoria. This is not the painting that was in the 1858 exhibit. It's an example of Landseer's work and includes a deerhound. Right, let's see. I think there's a, there it is. Well, yeah, it doesn't work so hard. But the deerhound is the tan dog. And the piece submitted by Landseer to the 1858 exhibit was of a Scotch staghound, as it was described in the catalog. Life-size and considered of strong character.
set the New Bedford standard. And it was a painting owned by Gideon Nye, originally from this area, who was a China trade and East Indian merchant. Whoops. There were a number of paintings by Johannes Adam Mortel, who was an expatriate living in the United States. He was a minister, which is somewhat evident in the pieces that he submitted to the exhibit. And that in that image of him on the right in his studio, you can see the painting Jeremiah, which was one of the paintings of his in the exhibition. Benno Friedrich Turmer, Last Hours at the Abyss. This was one of the few paintings in the exhibition which actually didn't get that great a review from the Republican Standard. While the paper admired the minuteness of the execution of the painting, it said you needed a microscope to examine it. They said they disliked the crudeness and hardness of it, and the attempt in them to throw a poetic charm over the miseries of combat life. Now you can see there were a number of, there's an emphasis of the European painters in this exhibit on genre painting. An exception was Alexandre Calam, whose painting of Lake Lucerne was included in the exhibit. Calam was a Swiss artist who by this time had achieved an international reputation. He had obtained a gold medal at the Paris Salon in 1841, and his Lake Lucerne had received high praise. It's one of only two landscape paintings by European-based artists that were included in the exhibit. Calam had met Bierstadt when Bierstadt was in Europe, and specifically when Bierstadt was doing the sketching at Lake Lucerne. And it happens that Calam's work was the work to which Bierstadt's alpine scenes were most often compared. However, there were two paintings in the exhibit, this isn't one of them, but that were singled out as being the most important in the exhibit. One of them was by Emmanuel Lutz, who's Washington Crossing the Delaware is the piece who he is most famous for, and by Andras Achenbach. The Lutz painting that was in the exhibit was a large painting, historical painting of Frederick the Great. I could not find an image of it. I don't know if it survives. It was a painting that he had done in Germany. He was doing a number of commissions at the time. It had never before been exhibited in the United States, and was considered a big deal because Lutz in this country was considered such a big deal. His fame rested on his Washington Crossing the Delaware painting, which was done a few years earlier. He had attended the Dusseldorf Academy, and while he was in Dusseldorf, became something of a mentor for the numbers of American artists who were in Germany at the time, including Albert Bierstadt. Giving them money, apparently, when they needed it, and then finding places for them to stay, or it extended beyond art instruction. And he was a major proponent of Bierstadt's work. So a number of the artists who were exhibiting here had some type of connection to Bierstadt, or who Bierstadt's connections in turn were linked with. The Achenbach painting that was exhibited was called The Shrimp Fishers. Again, I could not determine which of his shrimp fisher type paintings was the one in the 1858 exhibit. So I'm using the ebb tide here as a substitution. It's similar in theme and similar in handling. Achenbach was considered one of the major painters in the Dusseldorf school, and was described at this time period in the 1850s as being one of the greatest living landscapists of Europe. When Bierstadt actually went to study in Germany, he had hoped to become one of Achenbach's students, but the other American, young American painters who were there at the time. After looking at studies Bierstadt had, this would have been in 1853, sort of discouraged him from going to Offenbach and trying to gain admission to the academy because they thought he'd be humiliated since his works were so bad. So he never did get to study with Offenbach, but again, he did meet him eventually. And Offenbach, as a proponent of the Dusseldorf School, was very influential to what became known as the Hudson River School of Artists. The whole Dusseldorf School was, in that in Dusseldorf, there was an emphasis on landscape painting as being on par with, say, monumental history painting or literary paintings. And that was the only venue in Europe that really kind of had that attitude towards landscapes. Other significant painters who participated were members of either European academies or our own national academy. If they weren't at the time in 1858, they later became so. Several, as I mentioned, worked alongside Bierstadt, and many of the others were already at the 10th Street Studio building, which had just been erected in New York City, or would eventually become denizens of the 10th Street Studio buildings, who would be working alongside Bierstadt and then eventually William Bradford. Thomas Sully was one of the more famous artists in the exhibit who, although British born, was thought, was considered American. And he submitted his copy of one of his versions of Gilbert Stuart's Monroe Lennox version of George Washington. Sully had been a member, a mentor to William Allen Wall, who also participated in the exhibit. Moses White, who is not a known name today, but at the time, he was a Boston-based artist trained in Paris, and his painting of Baron von Humboldt, the naturalist, was included in the exhibit and had achieved great fame in Berlin, which is where it was painted, where it was exhibited at the Art Union there. And of the majority of paintings, in addition to genre, historical painting, painting based on literary subjects, and portraits, were landscapes. And actually just under half of the 150 images in the exhibit, the majority were, just under half were landscapes. So actually the majority of a single type, subject type, were landscapes, and the majority of them were done by Americans. The first generation of Hudson River School painters were generously represented. Frederick Church, of course, had to be included, and you keep in mind that before the 1820s or so, there were relatively few landscape painters in America. Primarily, American painters were working as portraitists. The Hudson River School painters were considered the first homegrown, coherent, sizable number of artists dealing with a specific subject matter, that is landscapes, and its success was directly tied to the nation's increasing urge in the 19th century to record and celebrate its primitive and untapped natural wonders. Church was regarded as the leading name in landscape painting, but he was only represented by this comparatively small sketch in the exhibit. I believe this is the sketch that was in the exhibit. It was simply titled South American Sketch in the Catalog, but it was described in the New Bedford Standard as being scenery of the Andes, in which a snowy peak, a palm tree, and foreground vines and flowers are prominent. If it isn't this sketch that's now in the MFA, it was a very similar image. And it was these images that ultimately became the basis for Church's
Heart of the Andes in the next year, which is a painting that received wide acclaim and was deeply influential in terms of its scale and in terms of how it was presented to young artists like Bierstadt and Bradford. Asher B. Durand was included, as well as Thomas Cole, who had passed away by this time. Cole was considered the founder of the Hudson River School, and he was represented by what was called a piece of Catskill scenery, which I, there's a lot, so it would, needs to be more research trying to pinpoint which Catskill image it may have been. But this is the painting by Durand that was included in the exhibit. Sanford Robinson Gifford, another artist who spent a lot of time in Europe with Bierstadt, was represented by six works, including these two. John Frederick Kensett, although Kensett was not mentioned in the Republican Standard article in particular, this was the painting that he had submitted. There was also a painting by George Innes called Summer Afternoon. William Trost Richards, another of Bierstadt's European companions, exhibited View in the Adirondack Mountains. And other painters who represent those early Hudson River School landscapists, like Samuel Lancaster Gerry, who was Boston-based. Sylvester Phelps Hodgson, whose Echo Lake was exhibited. He and many of the other painters sort of became part of this subgroup that has been named in more recent years as being White Mountain artists. And there was one woman in the show, Anne Sophie Town Darva. This was the painting. And she was considered, today, a White Mountain artist. She's originally from Philadelphia, started painting around 1845, eventually moved to Boston. She studied with Paul Weber, who was represented in the 1858 exhibit by four pieces. At the time she participated in this show, she was rising in reputation, although she is not particularly well known today. Her reputation was such that in 1882, when she died, she was given a memorial exhibition by the Museum of Fine Arts that included 60 oils and 202 watercolors. Now, the person who, the artist who had the single most numbers of paintings in the show was Albert Bierstadt. He had 14 paintings of his. And the surprise to the local paper seemed to be the fact that there were artists in New Bedford. The Republican Standard wrote, "As to the New Bedford artists, it is quite surprising to find how many and how excellent or promising ones we have. The exhibition reveals to us their number and how well they compare with the most noted painters. There are positively seven of them, if not more. Two landscapists, two marine painters, two portraitists, and another who pursues both portrait and history," which I assume is William Allen Wall. Bierstadt's works were all from his European travels, and they ranged from this genre piece, the Roman Fish Market Arch of Octavius, to his first major monumental canvas. It was the largest painting in the exhibit, measuring 6 feet by 20 feet. His painting of Lake Lucerne, which was to bring him the first significant public notice on a national scale. He painted it in New Bedford, and a few months before the 1858 exhibit here in the city, it had made its debut in New York at the National Academy.
After the exhibition closed here in New Bedford, Bierstadt brought it to Boston, exhibited it there, where it was later sold for $925, the biggest sum he had sold the painting for up to that time. William Allen Wall was probably the artist who the locals would have been most familiar with. In 1851, if you look at the city directory for that year, Wall is the only person who's listed in the city directory as whose profession is artist. Wall, aside from a brief period of study in England, which Thomas Sully recommended, he remained in New Bedford, unlike Bierstadt and Bradford, who later both relocated to New York. The 1858 exhibit was probably the most major venue in which his works were ever shown. He showed these two paintings based on literary subjects, Rebecca and Rowena from Sir Walter Scott's Ivanhoe, and Nathaniel Hawthorne's Endicott and the Red Cross. And also an example of his portraiture, which was how he earned his living. His paintings are sort of this a little window into 19th century New Bedford movers and shakers. The portrait of James Arnold, which is at the library, is one of his better portraits. As a patron recently said to me, she asked who did the Arnold portrait, and I said, William Allen Wall. She said, I didn't think he was that good. So part of it may be the force of the subject, in that Arnold was a pretty formidable character. There's a more obscure painter who was, at the time, had a studio in the Ricketson Block building, Ernst Amthor. His submission were two portraits. Both were owned by Joseph Ricketson, Jr. And so presumably they must have been portraits of members of the Ricketson family. This is the only painting that I could scare up that is actually documented as being by Arthur. The other portraitist who was represented was Matthew Wilson, who had been living in New Bedford since about 1856, and the portrait of his that was in the exhibit was one of George Hussey, who was the son-in-law of Charles W. Morgan. There were also two paintings by a 17-year-old local named Robert Swain Gifford. One was Italian scenery and the other English fishing boat. And that seems like a very generous thing to have included paintings by a young art student who the New Bedford Standard said holds out fine promise. 17 years old, you've got your work exhibited in a venue that includes Landseer and Lloyd's. That had to have been something of a rush for Gifford, I would think. Albert van Beest, who's the Dutch artist who probably was mentioned earlier today in relationship to his work with William Bradford, was living and working in New Bedford in the 1850s. Two of his maritime-inspired subjects were included, and this was one of them, the Wreck. The Republican Standard thought it was an exceedingly effective small picture in which the artist took a familiar subject and made it new. Now, Van Beest's other pupil, besides Gifford in the show, was William Bradford, who was represented by two paintings, New Bedford Harbor and Sunrise on the Strand. Now, his reputation at this time was basically that of being a portraitist of ships. And the one depicted here is the Othello, over here on the left, which was owned by Thomas Nye, who also had commissioned this painting. The Standard accurately described Bradford's work as being very truthful, very accurate. But by this time, the results of his collaborations with Van Beest began to exert an influence on his compositions as they become somewhat more dynamic. that his work becomes more imbued with a more of romanticism, a good capital R. And he increasingly focuses on the effects of light. At this time, he's sort of just on the cusp of obtaining wider notice and wider audience. Now, despite favorable press, the New Bedford Art Exhibition apparently failed to attract the level of audience that Hopkins and Bierstadt hoped it would. Since at the end of July, they were noting in the newspaper that the admission fee had been reduced, and the Republican Standard published an article, they just titled it Painting, which I found very interesting. It was an article intended to try and encourage attendance, but it touches on the attitude that Copley had complained about and it expressed frustration with the previous century about artists trying to work and make a living in the United States. And this is taken directly from the Standard. To such as ask in reference to a work of art, what is the use of it? Very little can be said. The very putting of such a question shows either a mind destitute of those qualities which enable us to derive pleasure from what appeals to the imagination, or one which has so long been engrossed in material pursuits as to have completely deadened these faculties. To them, Niagara Falls is but a water power, a varied landscape, nothing but lumber, hay, and corn. They see no difference between the painting on a signboard and a picture by Alston or Turner. The Standard tried to note that art was not civilization, but it was a means to civilization. The power of a painter to preserve, quote, for the contemplation of future generations, the features of the great men of his own day, to imitate nature in all its varied phases, to stir emotions, surely the power to do all this is not to be despised, nor the pleasure we derive from it to be depreciated. So although it was hoped that this exhibit would be successful enough to turn it into an annual event, that didn't happen. Bierstadt's faith in the city's ability to support such an effort was maybe a little premature. In the end, the exhibit lost money, and in a letter to Bierstadt, he attributed part of that to the high cost of the expense of putting on the exhibit, which he felt it could have been pared down somewhat. But in a letter to John Durand, he also noted that he didn't really do that well in getting new subscriptions to Durand's journal, The Crayon. The only local who signed up was Bradford. And that Bierstadt then elaborated on the exhibit itself, saying, "We lost nearly $300 on our late exhibition year, so you see we have to bleed occasionally for the cause of art here as well as there, but we still have hope. We have planted some seed which will spring up and bear fruit yet." Now the exhibition, although not considered a rousing success, did plant a seed. And nationwide, as the century progressed, this reflected an increase in the stature of artists in this country. The exhibition signaled the beginning of what would become a rich local artistic tradition. The New Bedford Art Exhibition had given local artists a place to exhibit their work alongside major players in the international art scene, brought their work to greater attention. The wide range of paintings shown and the subject matter helped broaden the collecting interests of local area collectors. In the years following the exhibition, local tastes changed from a predominant focus on portraiture to a very ardent collecting of Hudson River School landscapes, works by Dutch maritime painters, works of different types of subject matter. Leonard Ellis opened his William Street Art Gallery in 1866, which was to become like a local mecca for artists.
in the same vein, but on a smaller scale, were the establishment of places like Lawton's Bookstore and Art Gallery and Hutchinson's. The Swain School of Design, Swain Free School of Design until the 1960s, was established in 1881 and had a profound impact on the development of artists in this region. Artists began to relocate from major metropolitan areas to establish summer residences in areas like Dartmouth. These were people like Dwight Tryon, for instance. Societies like the New Bedford Art Club and the Bedford Society for Fine Arts, Paint and Clay Club, all of these dedicated to the exhibition and promotion of local artists were created. And the careers of two of New Bedford's major artists really took off in the years after the 1858 exhibit. Both of them developed further the skills that they showed in the 1858 exhibit to subsequently create work that fed the public's appetite for exploration and discovery. In the 1860s, both Bradford and Bierstadt were being held up, not only in this country, but in Europe, as examples of the superiority of American landscapists over Europeans. Each became permanently identified with specific geographic areas. Bierstadt as the foremost painter of the American West, and Bradford as the foremost painter of the Arctic. So that's where I'm wrapping up. And thanks for your attention to my failing voice.
Well, thank you so much, all of you, for coming and for our wonderful speakers. I hope you learned something new about Bradford and got a little bit more context of his work, and I certainly did. And I'll be going to the Little Brinkmore Gallery just for a few minutes if anyone wants to stop by and take a look at that. Our next symposium is May 6th, which is about the Mariner's Home. We're opening across the street four new exhibitions, so that's May 6th. And are there any others before that, Sarah?
No, May 6th.
And then we have, I think that's the next one. And then we have the grand opening of that on May 19th, if you're interested in coming to see those exhibitions. So thank you all very much for coming, and hope to see you in our next program. Grab a calendar of events downstairs, or better yet, give them your email address,
right,
and
here,
you'll get updates on all of our upcoming programs.
Congress,
thank you.
Thank you very much.